was? Words.
For tears come the wild, wild west.
Was? Words.
Till our story is done. Till we together when our life story ends. So wherever we chance to go, wherever we chance to go, wherever we chance to go.
Was? Words.
Be friends.
You can sit in the pews or on the floor, or we can grab a few chairs from out there. Feel free to sit in the pew.
Marielle!
Hi.
I have
an
airplane.
Do you have
books?
I have books, yes.
I took one book with me, just so you know, if you thought you were missing a book, I have.
Okay.
But we probably won't need books for what we're doing.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about a couple singing things in general. Maybe, like, a couple questions, but mostly what we want to do is have people experience a little bit of a voice lesson here, okay? In front of our 30 closest friends, right? But the whole concept of what we're talking about is just to get the most natural and easy and free singing voice as possible. Okay? Cool. So, Richard kind of alluded to it at the beginning that there might be some things that you may have heard before, and there might be some things that might seem like heresy that might get me chucked out of the barbershop church. But I'm okay with that because now I work for the church and I get to tell them. I get to kind of control that. So, generally speaking, we create sound when air goes through our vocal folds and they're close enough together that they vibrate. That's not really a mystery, right? That we understand that. That's how sound is created, that there's something in vibration and it changes the way that the air molecules interact with each other. Just like a trumpet player on a mouthpiece, they buzz their lips and it vibrates the mouthpiece and it goes through the horn. Our sound, instead of going through a horn, it goes through our vocal tract. That's everything from your larynx to your lips. And it's basically a bent tube, like an elbow macaroni, right? And it's the size and the shape of that vocal tract that determines the sound that we hear. A violin, for example, has one resonating thing and it's the same one for every single pitch. We can have dozens of different combinations of resonating shapes based on a couple different factors like our larynx position, our jaw, our tongue. For example, if I say he and then hey, I change the shape of my vocal tract to achieve that different sound, and that's why they sound different to us. But I can also change the different colors that I have in my vowels by doing if I have my larynx here in the neutral position, I say hey, then I can have my larynx high, hey, then I can have my larynx low, hey. All three of those are the same pitch, right, the same frequency, but they were different laryngeal heights that made my tube different shapes. So I got a different sound. Look at that. And depending on what we want as our choral aesthetic, we get to kind of play with all of those different colors. And it may be text dependent. We may want to say something like, my darling, I love you so much, but if I have my larynx really high, my darling, I love you so much, that has a very specific characteristic to it. And that may not be what you're looking for if you're trying to be sincere. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Cool. All right.
The purpose of the breath, and maybe even very quickly,
talking about
the five or six or eight
different things that we've done in the past that were really only for one purpose.
Thank you for keeping me on track. I appreciate that. So I talked about the height of the larynx and how that changes the shape of our tube, right? You okay with that idea? Most of the information that you've received as a chorus singer or a choir singer or even as a soloist in church or at school or whatever, most of that instruction has to do with the height of the larynx. Right? If you ever heard these, and stop me if you have heard them all, if you have heard to sing with a big space in your mouth. Have you ever heard that before?
Yes.
Yeah. If you put your hand here on your larynx and say, big space.
Big space.
That affects your larynx a little bit. Have anybody ever been told to sing with tall vowels?
Tall vowels. Yes. It's especially what they're trying to get your choir kids to do. Tall vowels.
And that is an instruction actually to get your larynx to descend. Put your hand here on your larynx again. Now raise your soft palate really high. Did you feel your larynx go down? Yeah, the instruction to raise your soft palate is not an instruction to actually do anything with your soft palate because it's already raised. I've given about 4,000 voice lessons in the last 2 years, and I would say that I've come across like four people that have actually had to say, let's talk about your soft palate. So I can say pretty much that what you're doing already, there's no need to do anything with your soft palate. So don't try to do anything with it. Let's experiment with what happens, because sometimes these instructions come with baggage, right? Yes, it's doing something, but it's also doing something else. Put your finger right here in this muscle again. Now raise your soft palate really high. Do you feel that muscle contract? That's because there's a muscle that connects the tongue to the soft palate, and if your soft palate is already doing what it's supposed to do, and then you say, now do more, what's it doing? It can't go anymore. It's actually just tensing. And it's tensing something else too. Remember our definition of tension? That's using a muscle that is required for the task, but beyond what's necessary to complete it. Cool? I was told a lot to sing with like a dome in the back of my head, like a cathedral. And then that didn't work, so my teacher was like, it's more like a bow and arrow. And I was like, am I doing it? No. It's more bow and arrow. How about now? No, more. I'm trying. All right, here's one that's fun. I give a class sometimes called Barbershop Myths and Legends. And one that, because I was kind of giving these examples of, hey, what are some things that people have said that maybe aren't necessarily based in anatomy or physiology, but kind of more imagery-based. And the best one I've heard so far is that their director told them to sing to the row behind them and then hook it over their teeth like a hockey stick. So, in my mind, I try to go through Lost in Translation and end up in Denver somewhere, and it's a mess. And so I go... What? So, your body will try to do something, right? What is that? That's a lot of information. And some of the inherent traps in those kinds of instructions is that you may already be doing what is being asked for, and you're not. So if I say, all right, it's hockey stick back row time, you're like, boom, I got it. And you're like, and you're trying to do something that you already didn't need, and now you're going beyond what is necessary for the task. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. By the way, I figured out that instruction is to get the larynx to go down, because when you see my larynx? Okay. I guess. And the other one is, it has to do with the tongue position, to get the tongue high. That's a lot. Here's one that's semi-controversial, is to take a big breath, right? We've been told, take a big breath and then support, right? Have you heard these before? Why do we take a big breath?
We don't have to take another breath.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe, yeah.
So we have enough air to get us through the phrase.
That's usually what we think it is. And then a lot of times when we take a big breath and then we still run out of air, you would think to yourself, well, I ran out of air, therefore I need
more air.
I clearly do not have enough, so I have to take in more to get to the end of the phrase.
It's geometry.
And you still don't have enough the next time, right? So then what do you do again? You take more, try to take a bigger breath, and then you go to these conferences where they're like, no. Take a breath as if you're drinking a glass of water, or you have a belt full of noses, or you're smelling something fragrant, or you're breathing through your feet. Right? Or you're a balloon, and it's going this way. No, you have gills on the side of your neck. I've heard all kinds of stuff. Zombie breath. Suck the air out of the room. All that stuff, right? Just to get more air. Put a pin in the concept of the air for a second, but let's talk about the physiological response to that instruction. If I watch my larynx, right? You see where it is? Right? So if I take in a big breath, where did my larynx?